All right, we're so glad that you're here this morning. We're going to worship the Lord, so why don't you stand with us? The Lord is good, He's holy, and worthy of our praise this morning.
Darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory.
Good. He's awesome, isn't he? and he's holy and mighty. And Lord, we just come before you right now, and we thank you, Lord, for your presence here. Lord, you say that you dwell within the praises of your people, and that's what we want to do this morning, is to praise your holy name. Lord, for you are worthy. There is no one like you. There is no one who controls all things and are sovereign like you are. And so, Lord, we just thank you. And Lord, we want to rest in that this morning. We thank you that you meet us here as we come by faith, and we trust you. And Lord, we all have different needs and things that we have in our lives and situations and circumstances. You see it all, and Lord, you are over all things. And so we pray that we would find that place of rest in you this morning. Lord, because you are worthy of our praise, Lord, you're worthy to be exalted and glorified, and we want our lives to reflect the nature and the character of Jesus. And Lord, we want to see, Lord, your presence manifested through this very body that you've given us, and we just thank you that you do that as we surrender to you. So that's our hope, that's our prayer this morning in all things, Lord, that we would just be drawn to you, and you would be glorified and praised, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
is holy. He's awesome. His mercy is great. My
cross, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious
your prayer this morning to just give your heart to the Lord.
Yeah, this is my desire to honor you. Lord, with all my heart, I worship in me, oh, I
prayer this morning, Lord, that we would just be able to let go of our own thoughts and our the things that are in our life and just really let you have your way in our hearts and our lives. Lord, we want to hear from you. Lord, we desire for you to speak to us through your spirit, through your word, through the things that Pastor Jeff is going to share with us this morning. We thank you for your faithfulness and all of that. And that, Lord, that you know where each one of us are at, our different circumstances. Lord, you understand the things that are going on in the world. Lord, you see it all. And Lord, it's amazing as we just look at the world and we just see all the different things that are there and how you can really handle that. I'm sure some of it just really makes you really sad. And Lord, your compassion just goes out to those that are lost and hurting and broken. And yet, Lord, we know that your justice is there as well. And there's places where, Lord, your justice is being poured out. Lord, we just know that, Lord, you're working in all things. And, Lord, you are multifaceted in the way that you deal with mankind. So, Lord, we trust you. And we just thank you that we have a hope in, Lord, in who you are. And, Lord, we just thank you that you have the perfect plan, the perfect will. And Lord, help us just to see that and surrender ourselves and just to give ourselves to that. Lord, that you would be able to fill our hearts and our lives with just light and salt to the world that truly is in just chaos and needs you. And Lord, we know that you are the answer. Super simple. It's really easy. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and your neighbor as yourself. Lord, help us to keep it simple. Lord, because in that we'll see the fruit of, Lord, your Holy Spirit just busting forth. And so we thank you for that. Lord, be blessed this morning. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, would you just greet one another in the Lord this morning? So happy that you're able to fellowship with us. And the Lord is
pray. Amen. So turn in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 11. Again, we come to that infamous story of the Tower of Babel. This is one of the major turning points in the history of the world. Chronologically, the first 9 verses here in chapter 11, the Tower of Babel, I believe, you know, chronologically comes before chapter 10, because we saw in chapter 10 last week the Table of Nations, and it says they were scattered throughout the known world at that time. They went up into Europe, to Asia, all over the Middle East and Africa, and it says that they had all these different languages. Well, they all spoke one language here, as we'll see here in a moment. But then it's because of what happened at the Tower of Babel, God would get them to spread out, disperse, as he had instructed them. Again, it was after the flood when Noah's Ark comes to rest on the mountains of Ararat. They're about 17,000 feet in elevation. So the natural way they would leave from the Ark and settle would be going down what we call the Fertile Crescent. And it's really located between, well, it's like a, from your angle, a big arc. It starts in Israel, Jordan, goes up through Lebanon, across over Syria, southern Turkey, and it comes down through Iraq and Iran. That Fertile Crescent is basically the birthplace. That's where humans, after the flood, really started. We'll see it was in Shinar that they build this tower, which is present-day Iraq. And Babylon is where Babel, the Tower of Babel, was built. And so that's where they would have gone from Noah's Ark, traveling down southeast, from my perspective, southeast, into that region. 3 times God told Noah and his sons to be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth. So his instructions were very clear. You guys need to spread out, take your families, and go out and multiply and you know, repopulate the earth. As we saw in chapter 10, one of Ham's grandsons, the infamous Nimrod, hopefully none of you are a Nimrod, he was a rebel against God. That's what his name means. And from ancient history, Nimrod was the one who built what we call the Tower of Babel, also known as a ziggurat. It was a place where they were worshiping, not the Lord, but really we'll see they were worshiping themselves. His main objective was to keep all the people together in one place. And that's contrary to what God said. He said, I want you going out all over the world. And in a sense, you could say that God wanted the people to spread out and become more dependent upon the Lord. And you see throughout the world where there's more rural areas, the tendency is for more people to be dependent on the Lord. The more you cloister into cities, people become more dependent on each other instead of the Lord. And so that's why God wanted them to spread out. Nimrod wanted the people to stay together, become more dependent on each other, and ultimately look to him as their leader instead of looking to the Lord. So this tower that Nimrod would build would become a symbol of humanism and human autonomy, an attitude of self-centeredness and self-determination and creating their own destiny instead of looking to God and knowing his will for their lives. And this is something that has gone on throughout human history ever since the Tower of Babel. And this is something that Paul defines in great detail in Romans chapter 1. We won't look at it, but basically you can boil Romans chapter 1 down to humans willfully leaving the one true God and the knowledge and worship of the one true God. They leave that fact that he is our creator, he's the sustainer of our lives, and they begin to worship creation. They begin to worship themselves, and that's what happens all through Romans 1, and you see the devolution of man, where it goes from worshiping God to man to worshiping all the animals and creepy crawlies and everything else, and then God gives them over to a depraved mind and so forth. And so again, we see this all over the world today. This mentality has been sweeping through our nation for many years now, and it's easily recognizable. It's when people start boasting about their human potential. They start boasting about human ingenuity and scientific discoveries and how we can do anything we want if we just put our minds to it. But the problem is they leave God out of the equation. The Bible is clear that all the blessings we have come from God. And it was very clear when Paul was addressing the people of Athens in Greece there in Acts chapter 17. And as he's speaking to them, he tells them, God made the world and everything in it. God gave us life, breath, and all things. In him, we live and move and have our being. And that's really what it boils down to. But it's no mystery who is behind humanism and all the other isms, pantheism and polytheism and the rest of it, idolatry. It all comes from Satan. It stems from the lie of Satan. He and his demon cohorts have never stopped trying to get mankind to start looking to themselves instead of looking to the Lord. Get our focus off of Jesus and onto everything around us and find our meaning and purpose in creation rather than in the Creator. And we have to admit, Satan has done a masterful job in leading people astray and ultimately into eternal destruction away from God. He wants people on that broad road that leads to damnation. He doesn't want people on the straight, narrow road, which is Jesus. And so this is what Jesus says very clearly in Matthew 7, verses 13 and 14. There it is. Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and there are many who go in by it, because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to life, and there are few who find it. So why is it so narrow? Because it's only through Jesus Christ that you can have eternal life. Jesus made this perfectly clear. John 14, verse 6, Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. And so no matter how skilled a person is, or how influential a person is, or how important they think they are, without Jesus, everything they do will eventually turn to hay, wood, and straw. In other words, it's all going to burn up. It's all going to burn in the fire. But what we do for Christ in the power of the Holy Spirit will last forever and ever. You know, and Paul talks about that in 1 Corinthians 3, where we're building on the foundation of Jesus, walking in the Spirit, obeying the Word of God. And you know, there's a bunch of great proverbs that speak of these things. I'll just give you a couple examples. Proverbs 16:25, there is a way that seems right to a man, but its end is the way of death. And we see that again all around us today. There's a way that seems right. You know, we're doing good stuff, but the end is just death. It's not because they're not walking with Jesus. Proverbs 19:21. There are many plans in a man's heart. Nevertheless, the Lord's counsel, that will stand. It always has, and it always will. And we see that here in chapter 11. Picking up in verse 1, it says, "Now the whole earth had one language and one speech." And so again, in chapter 10, they are all speaking different languages. That's why I put this before chapter 10. This is almost like a parenthesis. But what language did everybody speak at this time? Well, nobody knows for sure. If I had to, you know, make an educated guess, I would say Hebrew. I mean, we've seen all the names so far in Genesis. They have their Hebrew names. They have Hebrew meanings. And so very possibly that's what they spoke. I would not bet my eternal salvation on that. But that's what I would say, possibly. I think Shem and his descendants did not get caught up in this rebellion at the Tower of Babel. And so they might have been the only clan that kept Hebrew as their language. And that's what the Jews have spoken for thousands of years. Be that as it may, verse 2. "And it came to pass as they journeyed from the east that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there." So when they leave Ararat, the mountains of Ararat, they would travel down south, and then they would head east. And so now they're coming from the east over to the plains of Shinar. Again, that is the fertile lands of Babylon at the time, where the Empire of Babylon started, the city of Babylon. Babel would be the place where this takes place. So instead of spreading out, like God said, they're in rebellion and they're all coming together. They're against the word of the Lord. Verse 3, "Then they said to one another, 'Come, let us make bricks and bake them thoroughly.' They had brick for stone and they had asphalt for mortar." So another interesting thing to take note of, they baked bricks for stone. And so it was a substitute for stone. Well, it's a cheaper substitute for stone. You know, normally bricks, they will break down much quicker than stone. The Bible talks about building with stone, building our life on the rock. We know the rock is Jesus. Bricks wear out faster. Jesus tells us, build our lives upon the rock, and we know he is the rock. It tells us again in Matthew 7, verse 24. "Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain descended and the floods came, the winds blew and beat on that house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock." So we know that Jesus is the rock upon which we build our lives, and it's also upon the rock of Jesus that he will build his church. When he says to Peter, "You're the rock," he's talking about being a little stone. But the rock that he's building upon what Peter said, that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. That's the foundation, who Christ is. 1 Peter 2, verses 4 and 5 tells us, "Coming to him," or Jesus, "as to a living stone, rejected indeed by men, but chosen by God and precious. You also, as living stones, are being built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ." So here's a question: are you building your life upon the solid rock of Christ, or are you building your life with your own tools, with your own plans, with your own resources? Or are you building your life, again, upon the solid rock foundation of Christ? Don't forget, building your life your way with your own tools, your own resources, will eventually, like brick, crumble and fall apart. But what you build your life upon Jesus, when you build your life upon Christ, a solid rock, that's going to last forever and ever. And that's why you got to build on Jesus and not on the crumbling things of this world. Now look at verse 4. This verse tells us a lot, as we'll see. It says, "And they said," so here's all the people there in Babel, "Come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower whose top is in the heavens. Let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered abroad over the face of the whole earth." So again, with Nimrod as their leader, they make it crystal clear that they are doing this in direct opposition to God. Again, notice they acknowledge that they are building a city for themselves. They're not building a city for God. They're doing this for themselves. This tower, it's not a monument to God in recognition of who God is and all that he's done, but this is a tower, they say, that is making a name for themselves. Notice also they admit that they know what God's will is for their lives, but they're refusing to obey it because God says, I want you to scatter, I want you to repopulate the earth. And here they say, lest we be scattered abroad over the face of the whole earth. Again, that was God's word and his will for their lives. By the way, the best way to know the will of God for your life is by spending time in the word of God, because the word of God tells us what God's will is. Many verses will say, and this is the will of God for your life. So that's pretty obvious. If he says this is my will for you, then it's like, oh, okay. I don't need to dig real deep. It's just like, this is my will for your life. And so we need to obey the will of God for our lives. And one of the things that I've discovered over the years is if I'm not willing to obey God's clear instructions when he says, this is the will of God for you, me, Jeff, if I'm not willing to obey that, then he's not going to be giving me further instructions that you might not be quite as clear finding in the scriptures. But it comes back to being faithful with the few things God has entrusted to us, and then he will bring the increase. But if our attitude is, nah, I'm not interested in God's word and what it clearly says, well, then don't be surprised when it seems like God is not speaking to you anymore. If you're not going to listen and heed what he tells us in his written word, then don't expect to hear that still small voice of the Holy Spirit saying, okay, Jeff, go up to this person and talk to them. No, I'll be just like, nah, I'm going to do my own thing. And you're not sensitive the way God might lead you and direct you. Notice again that they were building this tower, it says, in order to make a name for themselves. This word name means reputation. They're wanting to build themselves a reputation. They want a reputation, as it mentions here, that goes all the way up into the heavens, up in the atmosphere. We want our reputation to be known worldwide. And so they are not content in having God sitting upon the throne of his creation. They want to prove to God they deserve to be there also. We want to be right there with God, not to worship him, not to adore him, not to follow him, not to, you know, be in his presence, but this is speaking of being a rival to God. They're saying, literally, we want to be just like God. That sound familiar? Remember back in the Garden of Eden? That's exactly what the lie of Satan is. The serpent comes to Eve, and when they're talking about eating of the forbidden fruit, you know, it was the serpent who said, you know, you will not surely die, for God knows in the day that you eat of this, you will be just like God. That's the lie, and you see that throughout the scriptures where Satan is tempting people, take a shortcut. You don't need God. You can make yourself into a God. We talk about the lie there in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. They believe the lie and they reject the truth of God's word. The lie is you don't need God to make it up into the heavens. You don't need God for your life. You don't need God to lead you and direct you. You can do it all on your own. We see it throughout the scriptures, and that's what we're seeing here. Nimrod wants to lead the people into rebellion against God by trying to prove to God we can access godhood on our own. We don't need a relationship with God. We have ourselves. We will determine our own destiny. We will make ourselves great. We don't need God to do this. That's the basis of humanism. That's what it all boils down to. Again, we see it all around us today. That's the motivation and the philosophy behind almost everything we are seeing in our nation today. We don't want anybody telling us what to do. We don't want to submit to the authorities. We need to defund all the police stations and police, you know, officers. We need to get rid of them. Why? Because everybody wants to do what's right in their own eyes. That's what happens in the book of Judges. Everybody was doing what's right in their own eyes. That's a repeated phrase throughout Judges, because they didn't want God's leadership. They didn't want God's authority. And God works through governments, Romans chapter 13. He's the one that raises up leaders, and he's the one that puts them down. But we're living in a time, and we're saying, you know, we'll do what we want to do, however we want to do it. Again, that's what anarchy looks like, people doing what is right in their own eyes. And pretty soon you have lawlessness, you have mob rule, and wherever that has taken root in the history of this world, chaos will soon follow. That's what happened here at the Tower of Babel. They're pushing God away, and they're wanting to rule themselves. The ultimate ruler is God. His ways are just and true and completely fair. It's amazing how many people in our society today are crying for justice. We just want justice. No, you don't. Don't ever ask God to give me justice. I encourage you, don't say, God, give me justice. Give me what I deserve. You don't want that. If you ask God for justice, you're toast. I mean, you're going to end up in the lake of fire. That's what we deserve, because we've all sinned, fallen short of the glory of God. We've all blown it. In his perfect justice, he is required to punish each and every sinful person. And since the Bible is clear that we've all sinned, we've all fallen short of the glory of God, well, we all deserve his wrath and his punishment. But this is why the gospel of Jesus Christ is so glorious. Jesus, as the only begotten Son of God, who was perfect in all of his ways, perfect in his nature, perfect in his actions, he came into this world, he went to the cross in order to take all the punishment and wrath and judgment that we deserve, because we're the guilty ones. So the Bible tells us in places like 2 Corinthians 5:21, for he, that's God, made him, Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin for us. It's not saying he made Jesus, like created Jesus. He's just saying he made him to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. In other words, Jesus took our place. This is why John the Baptist said, behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. He would become the final perfect sacrifice for our sins. He would willingly go to the cross and take upon himself the wrath and judgment that you and I deserve. Again, when he's on the cross, remember what he cried out? When he quotes Psalm 22:1, my God, why have you forsaken me? Jesus crying to the Father, why have you forsaken me? It was at that moment in eternity that the Father was pouring out his wrath upon his Son, Jesus, who did no wrong, was perfect in every way. And yet he did that. So now he tells you and I will never leave you, I'll never forsake you. Why? Because Jesus was forsaken in our place. When we come to Christ for salvation, he comes into our lives, we are declared righteous. We're made holy, but it's not in ourselves, it's what Christ has done for us. In 1 John 2, verse 2, it says, and he himself, Jesus, is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the whole world. That word propitiation means that God's righteous wrath toward all of us was satisfied by Jesus Christ. One of the greatest pictures of how God's justice toward us was fulfilled by Jesus, and is also a beautiful picture of God's grace. It's found in Romans chapter 3, starting in verse 23, but this is what we read. It starts off by saying, for all have sinned. That's, my Greek isn't really good, but all means all in the Greek. So for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God set forth as a propitiation by his blood, there's that word again, through faith to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance God had passed over the sins that were previously committed to demonstrate at the present time his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. So God was completely just in dealing with our sins. How so? Because he had Jesus take all the pain, all the punishment, all the penalty that we deserve upon himself. And so Jesus satisfied the justice of God in our place. In other words, as the perfect righteous judge, God declared me guilty, but by his grace, God allowed Jesus to take the death penalty in my place. Praise the Lord. I mean, that is glorious because I know what I deserve and I know what I still deserve, but Jesus has imputed to me, to you, all who have come to Christ by faith, he has given us his very own righteousness. And so he declares us righteous. He is just and the justifier. In other words, he justified me, he justified you. Because now when he sees your life, he sees Jesus in you. He says, well, you have the seal of the Holy Spirit upon your life. He sees Jesus in your life. That's good with the Father. You know, that's why we're saved, not because of any good thing we could ever do. So he's completely forgiven all of our sins because Jesus redeemed us. He cleansed us by his perfect, spotless blood. And it's because of the blood of Christ, even as it says there in Romans 3, God has passed over the sins that we've previously committed. He's passed over the sins that we might be committing today. He's passed over the sins that we have yet to do, but we will, because none of us are perfect this side of heaven. This is why the Tower of Babel was such an abomination in the sight of God. Man trying in his own efforts through his religion to make it up into heaven. This is why all man-made religion is an abomination in the eyes of God, because any attempt on man's part to make himself equal with God or make himself holy and righteous before God in his own efforts, it's like a slap in the face of God. It's like going up to Jesus and spitting in his face and saying, you're not worthy, you're unable to save me. I got to do it myself. But as I've just demonstrated from God's word, nothing could be further from the truth. God has done absolutely everything for our salvation. He's given us eternal life. Greatest gift of all. And it was a free gift. You know, God demonstrated his own love toward us. And while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Amazing. That's why it's called amazing grace. The only thing God requires from us is simply to believe in Jesus as our Lord and Savior. The word believe, it's not a passive word because it tells us in James, the demons believe. So it's not just saying, oh, I believe in God. But it's an active word. It simply means you're putting your faith alone in Christ alone. We're no longer trusting in our own abilities, our own goodness, our own works to save us. We're just putting all of our faith and trust in Jesus alone, that he did everything for us. He's the only one that could wash us clean with his blood. He's the only one that could declare us righteous and holy and present us to the Father. Ephesians 2:8-9, it summarizes it so beautifully, a lot better than I could. God says, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. Again, the only boasting we should ever do is boasting in how wonderful Jesus is, how powerful he is, how glorious Jesus is, that he is worthy of all praise. We boast in how amazing Christ is. Again, he alone is worthy to receive all glory and honor and praise. Now look at verse 5, because here we see from God's view what's going on here. God views everything Nimrod and the people are doing. So in verse 5 it says, but the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the sons of men had built. And the Lord said, indeed, the people are one, and they all have one language, and this is what they begin to do. Now nothing that they propose to do will be withheld from them. So here we see that the Lord comes down to check out what is going on with the people and with the Tower of Babel, which they built. Now, again, God is never surprised by what people do. You know, that's what we talked about last Wednesday in the attributes of God. He's omniscient. He knows all things. This is simply telling us, you know, the way it's worded here, how we can see what God is going to do in response to the people saying, let us go up into heaven. Let us build this tower up into heaven. Let us make a name for ourselves without God. And so we see here God coming down to check on their work. Now, the problem is not that all the people spoke one language. The problem is not that they're living and working together in unity. We'd like to see the body of Christ do that. Work together, work in unity. Paul talks about in Ephesians that we're to guard the unity of the faith that was once for all given to us. What does that mean? It doesn't mean we create some pseudo-unity by let's sing kumbaya, find the least common denominator we can all agree on in the Bible. Well, if you don't believe in Jesus being God, or if you think, you know, the Holy Spirit is dead, or, I mean, it's like, we can't agree. There's no unity in that. You know, we don't just try to come down to this area where, well, we can agree that, well, maybe this is God's word. No, we can't agree on those things. The unity of faith is we believe what the Bible says about who God is, the way of salvation. These things we don't, you know, get wishy-washy on at all. So God comes down here, and he sees what they're doing. They're in unity. We need to be in unity. What do we need to be unified on? Preaching the gospel of Christ to a lost and dying world, teaching God's word verse by verse. I think from Genesis to Revelation, the whole counsel of Scripture, as Paul tells the Ephesian elders, you know, trusting the Lord and leaning not on our own understanding. So the problem is not that they're working together. The problem is with Babel, they were unified, working together in rebellion against God. That's the problem. Their unification was built on rejecting the word of the Lord, coming against God. And so what God is about to do is actually an act of mercy. I mean, he had every right to just wipe out all these rebellious people, but instead, he's going to confuse their language and scatter them, is what he told Shem, Ham, and Japheth way back. This is what I want you to do. They weren't doing it, so God's will be accomplished. So when God says in verse 6, now nothing that they propose to do will be withheld from them, that's another way of saying that if the people achieve their goal of complete rebellion against God, then everything they do, everything they propose to do, will take them further away from God's love and compassion and truth. Again, we're seeing this more and more throughout our world today. Mankind believes he can build anything he wants to believe. He can create a utopia on earth without God. I mean, most scientists today, most environmentalists today, most politicians are doing this. But every time we leave God out of our plans, we're inviting confusion and disaster. Tower of Babel means confusion. And this is the result of man-made stuff without God. That's true for each individual that says, I don't need God, or there is no God, as well as a society that believes, oh, no, government, that's the answer to all of our problems. You think so? I don't think so. Our nation right now is in big trouble. Not only are we living like the people in the days before the flood of Noah, we're living just like the people in the days of the Tower of Babel. That attitude is still here. So God sees what's going on, and then he says in verse 7, come, let us go down there and confuse their language, that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord scattered them abroad from there over the face of all the earth, and they ceased building the city. Therefore, its name is called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth, and from there the Lord scattered them abroad over the face of all the earth. So again, one way or another, God is going to accomplish his plans and his purposes. And this is how he gets the people to scatter all around the world, as he already told them to do. Now, there's a couple of things to take note of here. The word Babel has two meanings. First of all, as it mentions here, the Lord confused the language. Babel means confusion. And so all of men's efforts and philosophies and technologies apart from God will lead people to confusion. And look how confused we are today. Despite everything we have, we are more and more confused about basic truths. We're confused about truth and lies. We're confused about right and wrong. We're confused about reality and myth. Our society is so confused today. God is not confusing. God's word is clear. Isaiah chapter 5, verse 20 says it like this: "Woe to those who call evil good and good evil." If I broke into your house by throwing bricks through your windows and then hauling off all the stuff out of your house, is that good? No, it's evil. And yet here's our society saying, oh no, this is good. People are expressing themselves. Really? Okay. The Bible says don't overcome evil with evil. Overcome evil with good. That's what we're supposed to do. Overcome evil with good. God has given us what we need to come against these things around us, but it's the truth of God's word. Walking in the Spirit, having the fruit of love, joy, and peace being the foundation upon which we're building our lives on Jesus, and not getting into people's faces and yelling and screaming. That's not doing good. But what are those who call evil good and good evil? Who put darkness for light and light for darkness? Who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter? I remember a few years back, Elizabeth likes tea, and you know, this is when she was having, you know, sugar in her tea, and I grabbed the wrong thing and I put a bunch of salt in it. And it was, she's like, "What is this stuff?" And it's like, "Oh, what do you mean? What's wrong with it?" Oh, yeah, you don't substitute sweet for bitter or bitter for sweet. Woe to those who are wise in their own eyes and prudent in their own sight. So confusion, we're seeing that all around us today. Secondly, Babel also means Bab-el. It means gateway to God. This is what they're really doing. This is the heart of religion, trying to make a way to God. That's what every religion in the world does, trying to make a way to the Lord, coming in our own efforts before God. Again, religion, trying to reach God in our own efforts. This is why Christianity is so wonderful, because Christianity is the only so-called religion where God came to us. He reached down to us. He presented Jesus to us as the only way of salvation. He established a relationship with us. This is why Christianity is so glorious when you understand the truth of what Christianity is. It's not religion. It's not going to church and then doing a bunch of rituals, rules, and regulations and think, oh, I'm good now. I can live any way I want the rest of the week. A lot of you came out of systematic religions like that. They call themselves Christians, but they're doing all these rules and rituals and regulations, and it's not a relationship. God established a relationship. We saw God came in the cool of the evening to hang out with Adam and Eve in the garden. That's what God desires. He establishes a relationship through Christ. Jesus says in John 15, verse 5, "I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. And notice, for without me, you can do everything you want." No, you can do nothing. We can't do anything. But unfortunately, the world says, oh, yes, we can. We can do anything we want to do. We can build anything we want to build. And with our computer technology and capabilities today, we can know more than anybody has ever known in the world before. Which may be true, but their attitude is, so we don't need God. And that's the problem. Here we see the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit in verse 7 saying, "Let us go down and stop them." Basically, before they destroy themselves once and for all. So by confusing their languages so that nobody could understand one another, That's when they finally start to disperse and go into these other regions like we saw in chapter 10, up into Europe and Asia, the Middle East, North Africa, and so forth. It's quite possible that each family group could understand just their immediate family, and then their cousins over here, that group, they're just babbling. That's why it means babble. It's just confusion. We don't understand what they're saying. And so that's why that confusion dispersed them throughout the different regions of the world. Now, Jesus Christ is going to come down again after the 7 years of Great Tribulation, which takes place right after the rapture of the church. Then Jesus, and we're going to come back with him. He's going to come back to earth. But when he comes back, it's on the brink of this world being annihilated once and for all. It's on the brink of this world in total destruction. You've got 7 years of tribulation, God's wrath being poured out, demons let loose, and they're just creating havoc all over. And then you've got the Battle of Armageddon, where the world's now involved, trying to blow everything up. And so just before the world is on the brink of annihilation, Revelation 19, starting in verse 11, Jesus descends on the white horse. And we come back, it says, with him. The armies of heaven clothed in white and clean, following him on white horses. And then he comes and he establishes his kingdom on the earth. It tells us in Matthew 24, verse 22, and unless those days were shortened, no flesh would be saved. But for the elect's sake, speaking of the Jews that survived the Great Tribulation, those days will be shortened. And it's only when Jesus returns and sets up his kingdom on earth, then we will experience a genuine utopia for 1,000 years. Why? Because Jesus is the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. He will be ruling and reigning upon the earth for 1,000 years, and it's going to be glorious. Here's another question. Do you have or are you building any Tower of Babels in your own life today? In other words, are there any areas in your heart where it's in rebellion against God? We often do that, whether we're conscious of it or not, and we'll find out after the fact, wow, my attitude really stinks. I've been trying to do this on my own strength, do that in my own power. Be careful. The Bible says rebellion is as a sin of witchcraft. It goes on to say, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. So we don't want to be stubborn against the Lord. We don't want to be in rebellion against the Lord. Now, when people unite together with God, that's a beautiful thing to behold. When we're united together with the Lord, obeying the Lord, walking in his ways. But when people unite together without God, it gives people a false sense of power that can lead them into further rebellion against the Lord. And so as we unite together with Jesus and the body of Christ functions the way it's intended to function, then Jesus gets all the glory and not any person. Then Jesus is lifted up and not any church. Then Jesus gets all the honor because he alone is worthy. Amen. Amen? Amen. Let's hear it now. Oh, I forgot. Happy Father's Day to all you fathers. Let's close in a word of prayer and worship the Lord, hopefully worshiping him in spirit and truth. Just give your heart back over to the Lord. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. I mean, anything good in our lives, we give you the credit. We give you the glory and the honor. Lord, we know apart from you, we can do nothing. As Philippians 4:13 tells us, we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. So Lord, I pray that we would just submit ourselves once again to you, that we would not sit upon the throne of our own hearts if any of us have tried to wiggle our way back up. Lord, we just pray that you would sit fully upon the throne of our hearts and lead us and guide us through the power of your Holy Spirit and the truth of your word. Lord, we can't produce anything good in our lives, but as we yield to you, we know that the greatest ministry, I believe, of the Holy Spirit is to produce the fruit of the Spirit within us. And Lord, I pray once again that you'd refresh us, you would renew us, you would begin to produce good fruit in our hearts once again, the fruit of love and joy and peace and patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. Lord, when we're walking in the Spirit and the fruit of the Spirit is produced in our lives, people in this world can stop and taste and see that the Lord is good. And so may we be vessels of honor for your glory. May we just point people to you, Lord Jesus. You alone are worthy. And we give you all the glory and honor that you alone richly deserve. And thank you, Lord, for saving wretched sinners like us. Thank you, Lord, for being the God of second chances and third and fourth and however many times we've stumbled and fallen. Lord, you're faithful to pick us up. And even if there's someone here today that's like the prodigal son, they've kind of wandered. They found themselves in a mud hole wrestling the pigs for carob pods. It says when he came to his senses, that son got up out of that mud hole and said, if I will just humble myself and go back to my father, maybe he'll take me back as one of his servants, one of his slaves. But Lord, we thank you that the picture is you running out to that prodigal and you wrapped your arms around him. You didn't beat him. You didn't threaten him. Lord, you clothed him with your robe. You took the finger off your hand and put it on him. You had a glorious celebration. My son who was lost has been found. My son who was dead is alive. Lord, that's your heart for each one of us, no matter what we've done, no matter where we've wandered off. Lord, if we truly are your child, then we thank you that you love us so much and that you're willing to bring us back into your presence. Your throne room of grace is open 24/7. And Lord, we need your grace. We need your mercy. We need your help. And so Lord, as we look to you, may you strengthen us and encourage us. And Lord, as we see a world around us that is so caught up in turmoil and anger, bitterness and hatred, Lord, we pray that the gospel, the good news of Jesus, would somehow work its way into people's hearts and minds. We pray the Holy Spirit would bring conviction into their lives of sin, of judgment, of righteousness. And they would turn from their evil ways and turn to you. Lord, we know that you don't desire for any to perish, but for all to come to repentance. We thank you, Lord, for your goodness and grace. May we be vessels of honor that you take into this world around us and bring that living hope wherever we go. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's stand together and let's worship the Lord.
Take these hands. I know they're empty, but with you they for beauty in your perfect plan. All I am is yours.
Take these feet.
Oh, take these feet. I know they stumble, but you use the weak. You use the humble, so I'm letting it go, a living sacrifice.
Pray. Father, we thank you that we belong to you. We are safe and secure in your hands. No one can snatch us out of the hands of Jesus. Lord, we thank you that you gave us eternal life, not temporary life, but eternal life with you. And yet, Lord, we know in this relationship that we have with you, we can grieve the Spirit, we can quench the Spirit. Lord, we know we do things that aren't always pleasing to you, but we thank you, Lord, that all we need to do is humble ourselves, confess that to you, not for salvation, but confess that to you because we just want a more intimate, open, honest relationship with you. Lord, you provided everything, and so we thank you for your grace and your mercy, your love, your compassion towards us as your children. So, Lord, we just commit our hearts to you once again and pray that you be blessed and glorified in all that we say and do. And it's in Jesus' name we pray, and all of God's people said, Amen.